How you teach reveals your philosophy about the purpose, goal, and value of teaching and teachers. Paul tells the church that God gave the church teachers because teachers help take lofty concepts and explain them in a way that is easier to understand and apply in everyday life. However, like any gift or profession or calling, we have to learn. In fact, teachers may be the best learners out there. Now, it should be understood that teachers do not make students learn. Rather, it is the hope of the teacher that they will show the students a love of learning that the students will then adopt for themselves. Teachers foster imagination, creativity, order, direction, thinking, application, and self-awareness. While it is true that teachers know the end result of the lesson, it is their responsibility to guide their pupils to that desired end, all the while navigating them through the tumultuous terrain of their pupils' learning process. Let's look at the text, Teaching to Change Lives. The text is divided into seven chapters. These seven chapters explore what the author calls the laws of teaching. And like any good teacher, these seven laws create an acronym that spells TEACHER. The law of teacher. Teachers are always growing. A teacher is one who recognizes the consequences of how their physical health and social groups either better or hinder them as teachers. All things affect the teacher, both public and private life, through the consumption of various forms of entertainment and the means by which they continue in their own personal education. The law of education. How we learn determines how we teach. Abraham Maslow, psychologist, pointed out four levels of learning called unconscious incompetence, conscious incompetence, conscious competence, and unconscious competence.
How do these four areas affect
teachers' philosophies and practices? The ultimate goal of education is to teach people, not necessarily what to think, but how to think, how to learn, and why embracing failure is an important aspect of education. The law of activity. Maximum learning is always the result of maximum involvement. The detrimental effects of busy work cannot be overstated. Each lesson and activity provided by the teacher should have a purpose, that is, an outcome or a goal. How we do something is just as important as what we do. Here we recognize the importance of the activity is not the goal. Activity is the process to the goal. The law of communication. Every teacher has a bias. Every teacher has an agenda, and this is not a bad thing. Now, the bias and agenda may be bad, so to simply say having a bias or having an agenda is wrong is not true. However, the purpose of communication for the teacher is to truthfully impart information. This requires the building of bridges between the teacher and the pupil. Within communication, we recognize three components: the intellect, the emotion, and the volition. The great activity of the teacher is taking these three components and instructing the pupils how to put these into words, while at the same time doing that themselves. Like any aspect of teaching, communication is a skill, and the more the skill is practiced, the better one gets at it. The law of heart. How do we teach what impacts not just head to head, but heart to heart? Socrates identified the essence of communication with three concepts that he called ethos, or character, pathos, compassion, and logos, content. While we have to keep the content of what we are teaching in our minds, we must also remember who we are teaching. Embracing the tension between the teaching and the learning process enables us to answer the question, where does learning begin? The law of encouragement. Teaching is most effective when the learner is properly motivated. While it is true that the teacher acknowledges the particular goal and outcome expectations of an assignment or activity, students also possess needs. As a teacher, it is vital to recognize what needs each student has. It is true that no two students are the same, but there can be two students with the same needs. As discussed earlier, embracing failure is an essential aspect of personal education. How the teacher uses failure in regards to the student can have a greater impact than how the teacher uses successes. The law of readiness. The teaching-learning process will be most effective when both student and teacher are adequately prepared. This law also provides the basis for successful assignments. Not that every assignment will be a success, but that the goal of every assignment will always be about outcome. This also includes recognizing that silence is not always a bad thing, that tough questions will come, so be ready, and the importance of note-taking for the teacher and the student as well. After reading and studying this book, you should be able to do the following. Identify the 7 laws of the author's educational philosophy. Assess your own strengths and weaknesses as a teacher-student. Alter faulty preconceived notions on the role and expectations of a faulty educational philosophy. This book was selected by the IPHC and NHM Schools of Ministry for the following reasons.
This book provides a biblical foundation for a philosophy of education.
It also provides realistic and practical principles and outcomes for the teacher and the student. In addition to Teaching to Change Lives workbook, you have an additional assignment. Write at least a 1-page essay in Times New Roman, double-spaced, at 12-point font on the following topic. Identify which of the laws is an area of strength and which of the laws is an area of weakness. Of the law that is an area of weakness for you, please explain what you will do as a teacher to grow in proficiency in this area. This has been course MCP 2.11 in the Ordination Level 1 Credentialing Series. Upon watching this course, please read the assigned text, complete the workbook, and type your essay. Please print the essay and place it in the back of the workbook. This is the final online video for the Ordination Level 1 series. Please make sure that all of your workbooks and additional assignments are complete and given to the School of Ministry's director 1 month prior to the credentialing service. Blessings, and study to show yourself approved.